All right, the sun is blasting in here a little bit, and it gets cloudy a little bit, then the sun, kind of like our spiritual path, isn't it? A little bit of sun, a little bit of clouds, a little bit of sun, a little bit of clouds. That's good. We get used to the light, and then it's like too bright, and then the clouds come. We back off a little bit. Very good metaphor for our spiritual practice, where we crucify our expectations every day. Now, I've been going as fast as ever. If you know, just really, the acceleration is just so extreme. So it's everything that I can possibly handle, and yeah, I mean, reevaluating as we go, reevaluating and coming up with some, checking into some different possibilities. I feel the equalitarian society we have now is really a profane society, in that it actually, it hasn't worked. It hasn't worked at all. We are not ready for that. The idea that somehow we just casually mingle with you know, Dharma kings is ridiculous. We're not remotely ready for such a thing. And we did want to get rid of all of this hierarchy of reverence, okay? That's put in there for our own protection, to protect our spiritual practice. There's a reason for all that. Like the Tibetans have set it up very well. Tremendous reverence throughout their culture. They know what they have access to. They realize they can't just go up to some exalted lama casually or something like that. This is unthinkable. But in our culture, it's think like, well, anybody should just casually go up to somebody else. But this is ludicrous, you know. Because, like, for instance, the way I would talk if I could freely talk would just be completely different than what you expect, and throw you into a massive panic, shock, and then panic. The Dharma kings would be, you know, way, way more than that. So it's bad. You have to limit the access, if not capping it. This is what I'm looking at now. It'd probably be better if you say no access. No access. You don't have any access. Maybe occasionally there's some ceremony, some certain things that are, if you have the proper reverence, you can have some access. But you cannot just arrogantly think that you're ready for access to something that would cause you to just a complete freak out with your expectations. The mind is such, you can't play around with it that way. Our whole thing is steady, gradually getting used to less fear, expecting less fear, okay? Expecting less fear towards the peace of God every day. Crucify the previous expectations and now have a new set of expectations with less fear. This is something that needs to have a steady progress every day. You don't want to spike it by coming across a Dharma king, right? You don't want to spike it. Occasionally, you will have big boosts, okay? Occasionally, you will have big boosts, yes. But by and large, for my path, I've had access to the Dharma kings on many occasions. But by and large, they've left me alone to just practice. I don't have access to some guru in the world. I don't know. I have no idea where I would go to find any guru in this world. No idea. So all I can do is practice, you see. So I'm not afraid of coming across them. That would frighten me greatly. I mean, the idea of coming across any of the Dharma kings externally would be too much, you know, too much. I may be getting closer to being able to handle that a little bit, but honestly, you know, it's been too much for my whole life. You can't handle that. Who can handle that? We're kidding ourselves if we think we can handle that. So this whole democracy experiment idea of you know, let's get rid of prayer, let's get rid of religion, which is a whole system of reverence, which enables us to actually be able to get help without feeling too much help, and feel like it's capping how much help we can get, so it takes the pressure off of us, so we're able to actually practice. If you think, oh, I'm going to see the Dalai Lama tomorrow, are you going to be able to practice the way we're practicing right now? No, you wouldn't. You'd be all jittery, you'd be panicking, you'd be shocked, oh my gosh, and your practice would go to hell, you know. It just wouldn't work at all. So you don't want that kind of opportunity. There's some opportunity you don't want, actually. It interferes with your steady practice. And we need to chip away at our fear of the peace of God. It's unbelievably entrenched, our habits of evaluation and our belief that if we don't fixate hallucination, we'll have an abyss. You know, that is, you know, so severely ingrained in us as a habit that we can spend a lifetime slowly chipping away at this fear. And even then, we might still have some leftover, some to go. So, there you have it. Now, capping expectations needs to happen for us to actually get down and do the work we need to do. People simply aren't doing the work, I see, in the Western world. They're not doing the work because their expectations are so high. They're too high. It's like, well, yeah, when Jesus comes back, I'll talk with him. That'd be great. Jesus came back. He said, I'm back, you know, in the spirit of friendship to relate as a friend with you in that spirit. He didn't say you're going to have access. He says, who's willing to do that? And I was the only one that stood up. But even then, I was shaking like a leaf. And so maybe he was just showing us, hey, okay, you think that you're ready? Okay, I'm giving you the opportunity. He gave us all the opportunity. Almost nobody took the opportunity. They can't. Too much fear. So we may need to go back and reassociate with a reverence-based society, culture. And that will enable those who are really willing to actually get down to work instead of just hoping that something really big's going to happen in terms, you know, some... That's all based on a false premise. Okay, false premise. Now, I may... It's suggested to be maybe I should cap any access to myself. The way that I'm going now, as far as my clarity goes, it's probably wise to do so. Now, before I was thinking, well, maybe people can have access to me and such. And I said, well, if there's a system of reverence set up that people realize that they have these safeguards, at any moment they can opt out, that takes the pressure off of them. That's a different story. But we don't have that in the world really anymore. It's been termited. So capping access, you know, to myself, saying, no, nobody can have access to me, will actually help people. It takes the pressure off. They're like, oh, great, I can just not worry about that and just keep practicing to the best of my ability every day. That's what needs to be done anyway. And if there's a big boost that needs to happen, then that can happen. But again, overall, the vast majority of your life will be this steady practice without feeling too much pressure. I've never been pressured to go see anybody. You know, the Holy Spirit says, no, don't go see them. Just keep practicing. And then somehow the blessings come from that steady practice. I've received a lot of big boosts from within that will happen. You don't even have to have them from externally, actually. You don't. You really don't. I really haven't had big boosts externally. It's all been internal. So there's some heavy, heavy, heavy turnarounds that need to take place. And what we have to do is lessen our fear level. Lessen our fear level towards the peace of God. Which is non-evaluation, experiencing the final evaluation, which is really like a non-evaluation. We have to lessen our fear levels. And as we do that, automatically clarity will arise within us. It does for me every single day. So I may not tell anyone where I am. There's no access to my life, to me, to anything at all. And that'll take the pressure off for everybody. Tremendous help to take the pressure off. So nobody thinks like, oh, I got to go see him or something like that. No. Nobody should come see me at this point. That's too much pressure. I'm able to see so easily now the whole situation It's too way too much pressure and fear. If you try to do that, you have to do it gradually. Lessen your fear levels and expect less fear. We are prisoners of our expectations, and it's futile to try it and just get rid of all expectations. It's pragmatically not possible. Okay, so we still will have expectations. We have to just gradually reshape our expectations, and that's very difficult to do. It's doable, but you have to stick to a certain practice, way of practicing, that doesn't stress you out too much. Otherwise, you're going to quit. So you have to realize that you're going to, it's like working out. You know, like today I feel terrible. I feel so tired and sore. Well, I've been working out a lot. And so you know you're going to pay a price, and I'm willing to pay it due to incentive that I really feel is an incentive to do this. And this is what we have to have. We have to have some incentive. So Jesus said, I'm back to relate with all you as a friend. There's an incentive there. That doesn't mean immediately he's going to do that. He's not going to impose his friendship on you. But it's an incentive that we now can use. So I've been working, you know, very diligently towards that aim, but still have, you know, quite a ways to go. This is how it works. Someone gave me this incentive to play golf at his exclusive private country club. And I was totally out of shape. My whole life had gone to hell. And I was giving up. And suddenly I said, oh my gosh, I can't really turn him down. You know, I better get in shape. And that just turned my life around. I never did play golf there. That's okay, because what was more important was the turnaround. I mean, I never forget that. That was one of the most important situations of my life. It was a very wealthy man, very nice man, and he just, you know, said, hey, you know, yeah, well, let's go play it at my golf course. I said, uh-oh. I said, oh yeah, that'd be great. I don't think I'm ready. I'm still not ready, but it's been almost 2 years of trying to get ready, and certainly that's been beneficial. Okay, very beneficial. It's been spiritually beneficial. So the incentives we get, even though we may not directly realize those incentives, are super important. Those are very big boosts. So somebody in a high position offered me something, and I said, I'm not ready for that, but I better get ready, because what if he goes through with it? So it's important for those in high positions to occasionally offer some sort of incentive, like, hey, you know, maybe to push you, to get you really working. And it's a beautiful way, super helpful way. There's nothing else that could do it. I had given up. But the allure of that offer, I just couldn't pass it by, you know, and really, that's what triggered me to drop all my bad habits and pick up a whole new set of great good habits. Isn't that amazing? It wasn't even anything spiritual so much, right? It was just a chance to play golf at, you know, I've never done that before. No one's ever invited me to play golf at a private country club before. It's the first time that ever happened. And I've just been hoping for it my whole life. And finally, there was the opportunity. And I said, oh my God, I'm not ready. So I was just mortified by that. As I said, maybe not this time, but the next time someone asks me, I'll be ready. And I'm still not ready. But I'm working on it. I mean, I'm walking now. Can't run because of my knee, but I'm walking. I'm trampolining. I'm doing everything I can do to just really continue to up my overall agility and fitness and capability. And it's still, again, I still feel like I have a ways to go. But I still feel able to incentivize myself. So this is super important to have some incentive. So Jesus is back. That's an incentive. He's back to relate with us as a friend, not some distant, awesome God figure. And that puts a lot of pressure on us, also a lot of incentive. And I you know, I've been making great breakthroughs, but nothing that much different than what I've done before. It's just clearer, and I can see it all kind of all at once, the whole big picture of it, and just say, wow. But there is some great breakthrough I had today that I can go over, and we understand what this is quite shocking to us. So this is a practice here to hear this and to realize, wow, this is see what the shock is we think this world protects us from clarity, and we made it as our hiding place. And to hear that it doesn't really protect us, that we can actually see what we're doing, even when we're here in this world, that is very tough to take. As you got a little hiding place as a kid, and you know, the parents discover where it is, you go, uh-oh, they know where I am. It certainly is quite shocking. And so we have to go through this full stop in the wow. And by the way, the wow practice is how we work on lessening our fear of the peace of God. We do it intentionally. We do it intentionally. We intentionally practice working on this fear, lessening the fear levels, and we absolutely can do it. There's definitely a practice, as we know, that succeeds at this. Easy practice. Easy practice, the wow practice, in its various guises, it really, really works. So there's a way we can do this. Easy, except you have to go gradually and carefully. Don't underdo it, don't overdo it. But if we can dedicate ourselves to this, then we'll be able to do it. It's that simple. And here comes the sun again, very bright. I kind of back off it just a little bit in the shade, like that. The duck out in the shade, like that. Duck into the sun, back off. Duck into the sun, back off. Duck into the sun, back off. Like that. This is like our practice. We get used to the bright sun that way. We don't want to get just put ourselves in it like that and just ah, it will cause shock, and we won't have the peace of God. Remember, practice is not an end in itself. Okay, it's not an end in itself. So we're not trying to say, I'm a great practicer. No, we're not. We don't say that. For the most part. If we're told by the Dharma kings we're very good, then we can accept that some designation of you know, a lot of skill and familiarity with it. But you still don't take it for granted. You don't say, I don't say, well, I don't feel like, well, I'm a great practicer. I feel like, you know, I could fail at this, so I better, you know, really pay attention to it and do it right. That's how I feel. Let me shift this over. Got to be careful. So I still feel I got to be careful, and it's not a given. I could easily go into panic if I don't, you know, watch it, because the insights are so strong. Definitely go into shock. It's not like I avoid shock. No, the better you get at this, the more steady and consistent you can get, and the more you go into shock every day. You're crucifying your expectations every day. Like you're a professional sufferer, you know how to suffer properly. Yeah, it's really like that, but it's what works. It's what backs us away from the edge of the fear of the abyss and the desperate hope in inducing some non-existent quality of mind to fixate the mind. Okay, that's the horns of the dilemma that we're on, because we think if we can't fixate the mind, then of course the minds could drop hallucination any instant. And evaluating it from the standpoint of believing that we have made a new creation, we don't understand that to drop hallucination, would mean to be aware of the reality of that, that is the one true creation. We take it like if we dropped hallucination, our new creation would suddenly turn into an abyss. That's the option we tell ourselves, which is completely wrong. But it just shows our how all in we are and our desire to create a new creation. So our trouble started when we decided we wanted to create a new creation separate from God, a different creation. We wanted to be a new prime creator. And in order to do this, we had to hallucinate the absence of the reality, creation. Hallucinate the absence of it. And then we had to imagine another creation, which we did by having all this variable value, less and more and less, good and bad, more and less. But the problem is, this is just being imagined, is that hallucination is not stable in the slightest bit. So we felt like the foundation of our new creation, there's something we needed to stabilize it. Because we felt very jittery and insecure and fearful. I said, what is this? What is this feeling? It was fear. Never felt that before. What's going on? Why do I feel so unstable? Let me see if I could. So what we did was we took this step, and we have to be aware of this. Okay, so we get a little jittery when we look at this, but the real crucial, you know, they're all crucial, but one of the most crucial steps we've taken is to, because we wanted to have a new creation, and we realized we weren't really going to be feel like it was a creation as long as we felt insecure, which comes from the fact that it's just a hallucinating the absence of God is the only way we can imagine a possibility of a new creation, and that's subject to the perfect freedom of mind. Mind can decide not to hallucinate the next instant. So we're not really we're not appreciating, quote-unquote, our new creation. We're not able to really feel like it's a creation. So we said the only way to feel like it's a new creation is to stabilize the mind, which means to fixate the mind. Stabilize hallucination, which means to fixate the mind. So what we have done is we have just imagined in a wishful thinking way that deep in our mind is an undiscovered quality which we have never come across before and God didn't even tell us about. Okay. We have to say this to ourselves. But there's this secret, hidden, reclusive quality deep within our mind somewhere that has the capability to fixate the mind. And what we've been trying to do is induce this reclusive quality, which we've never seen it, but we're hoping it's there, right? To induce it to come out into the open and fixate the mind for us. Now, it's trouble because there is no such quality in the mind. God did not create the mind with some hidden capability to fixate the mind. God did not create perfect freedom with some hidden ability to destroy perfect freedom. Okay. And so it's just a vain hope that we have. However, we got to be careful with this because we have built an entire belief system around this belief that it's there. This hidden quality is there. And it's just the reason why we're not experiencing it is that we've not been able to induce it. We haven't set the stage properly for it to arrive on the stage. So we're trying to set the stage for this so-called reclusive quality of the mind, reclusive capability to fixate the mind. We're trying to set the stage so it will come out on stage and say, oh, I can't resist. You set up a beautiful stage for some great singer and you say, look at this. This is deserving of you. Don't you think? You come out on that stage and it looks so great. So we've been trying to set the stage for this. And part of that is to worship this non-existent characteristic, to worship it. And what we've done is we've labeled this non-existent quality God. Okay? And we've been worshiping this non-existent characteristic labeled as God as if it's the true prime creator. And so we're, actually not, because the way that we're worshiping it is not the way we worship the true prime creator at all. It's very different. And we have to somehow account for the fact that this isn't happening for us, so we must be doing something wrong. So we say to this God, we know we're like doing something wrong, and we're terrible, and we've sacrificed everything to this non-existent characteristic that we hope exists, that we have labeled God. Do all these rituals and sacrifices and prayers and worship and stuff. I said, look, we really want you so badly to come out in the open. Why don't you do that? We'll do anything for you. We'll do anything to please you. As long as you've come out in the open. And so we've imagined this time, space, process, and form as a stage that we think can induce this characteristic to come out on the stage and say, wow, what a nice place this is here. Yeah, I kind of feel like living here, you know. And then we'll say, yeah, you can, but first you have to fixate the mind, because this is all our imagination, it's our creation. But if you fixate our mind, we'll let you live here. Hey, how about that? So that's what we've done. We've imagined this world, bodies, everything here, time, space, process, and form is all our just imagination, setting the stage to try to induce this characteristic, imaginary characteristic. We hope it's there. To come out in the open and say, wow, I like this place. I love this place. I wanna dwell here. You see, I wanna dwell in this world. And that's why people got so excited when Jesus was here. They misinterpreted it and thought that this reclusive God that's capable of fixating the mind was finally so interested in this world that we have made with all its fighting and lust and death and all this stuff, you know, that it finally sent his only son. See, to send your only son in the ancient times was a token of the utmost regard. You see, it means a what do you call it? Between tribes, there's a treaty between the tribes of agreement, that mutual support sort of thing. That's why it was so important to them. The only son had to be the only son in order to make it a true alliance. And then he sent his only son to die here. Okay, which is our belief in fixation. So the misinterpretation of Jesus was to believe that this non-existent reclusive characteristic that's capable of fixating our mind, we hope, actually exists, and decided to make this alliance with us in token of, I love the world so much that I've decided to, yes, I finally am going to fixate the mind for you. So that's why everyone said, oh my gosh, we finally got the answer. Pretty shocking, huh? But that's not really why Jesus came at all, actually. That's a misinterpretation. That's only coming to light now, really. Only coming to light now. Jesus had to work so diligently to help this come to light. This, the label God, which most of the world uses, refers to this wished for non-existent characteristic in the mind, in our mind, that is capable of fixating the mind. And no such characteristic exists at all. This doesn't mean that God, the real God, doesn't exist. We just use that label and affixed it to something that doesn't exist. That doesn't mean the atheists come along and say, well, you see that God doesn't exist. No, how stupid is that? We just took the label God and transferred over to our hope that there's something that is capable of fixating the mind when there isn't. But the label God applied to the true God of creation, of all value, everywhere, always, that's valid. That's still valid. Of course, that creator, prime creator, is real. So to be able to talk like this easily and openly and just like casual conversation, I mean, yeah, it's great that we have this casual society and equalitarian society, no classes and everything. We think it's great. But what happens is it levels everyone down to the lowest common denominator, where no kind of high speech is allowed anywhere, because it's going to shock 99.99% of the population. And they say, well, that's not fair. So really, this whole classless system is a terrible system. It's a terrible system. It runs against our progress towards the peace of God. So people, the class system is way better, actually, for the way I'm seeing it now, is you have the Brahmin, the high class. You don't speak to them unless you're spoken to, and you don't just casually come into contact with them. And when you can go and listen to a speech they're giving, but you're there to listen, okay? And you're there on a lower level than they are. And this captures expectations of what kind of interaction you can have, which takes the pressure off of you, which means you can actually listen and absorb what they have to say, and without this feeling that you have to somehow step up in an equal relationship of dialogue with them. See, that puts impossible pressure on you. So we think we've made all this progress by getting rid of that. But what's happened is we have slipped down into an extremely profane culture and society. It totally stalled out. Just bogged down and turning to fun as the answer. You know, it's been a disaster, an absolute disaster. It's really designed for materialism. This whole democratic equalitarian society is designed for materialism, consumerist, and that's exactly what's happened. As you stall out progress towards the peace of God, you've got nowhere to go except materialism. It was really set up by the capitalist materialistic class to bring about a materialistic utopia. And then the arguments over whether socialism is better at bringing about a materialistic utopia or capitalism, they're both on the same side of the equation, aren't they? Both of them totally reject a class-based society, actually. India has been so successful in Tibet because they have a class-based system, especially India. And people know where they stand. So they're relaxed about that, and they can focus in on their spiritual practice, and they know where, and they know, you know, what their expectations are and what the cap is. It takes the pressure off of them. Here, everybody is under so much pressure. It's crazy. We're all scared, and we're on a panic state, which brings us into materialism. Bye, 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 bye. Bye, bye, baby. Fun and bye, fun and bye. Crass, profane culture here in the United States and in the Western world and in the world in general right now. Extremely, the more we've discarded class system, the more profane the culture has become. So we have to, the go forward, people have to voluntarily opt back into a class-based system and a guru system and a system of reverence, so they're able to cap their expectations of interaction, okay? Interaction is restricted. It's a feeling of overall friendship to be here, but there's safeguards to cap interaction. It's very important. It's an incentive-based system, class-based, incentive-based, meaning you can have more access if you are able to, you know, reduce the amount of fear that you have through primarily diligent practice. But you may not want more access, really. Really. I mean, I don't really want more access, really. I just want to practice successfully, actually. I'm reluctant. More access, I would be reluctant to do that. That might stall me out. I don't want to stall out. I'm doing great just the way I'm going right now. I'm doing tremendous. Now, they may say, well, you can handle more access at this point, but I'm very reluctant, you know, to even entertain such a notion. But if they say I need to do that, then I will. But I'm still like, you know, you're up there, you know, I'm down here. Okay, so let's not blur the distinction here. But I'm certainly, you know, making great progress towards the peace of, to lessening my fear levels concerning the peace of God, making tremendous headway at that. And that's the real goal. Having access to the guru is not the real goal at all. It's the peace of God is the real goal. Jesus is not the goal. See, that's why he said, I'm back here as a friend. He's trying to say, look, I am not the goal. The person, Jesus, I'm not the goal. The peace of God is the goal. Okay, you're the guru of your own path. So don't make an idol out of me. He's trying to shift off of idolizing him, you see, believing that he has knowledge about how to fixate the mind, and he could go to God and say, God, these people are so wonderful that I want you, I'm asking you to fixate the mind. And God will say, okay, Jesus, for you, I'll do it. That's what we're hoping. This is ludicrous, of course. Ludicrous. There's no such capability to fixate the mind. Therefore, we can't have a new creation. We can't feel like we have a new creation. We cannot feel that way. We cannot. So we have to transfer our feeling to the peace of God. And what the peace of God does is it values our beautiful creativity in attempting to set the stage for this non-existent fixation. It honors the beautiful creativity and effort we put into it. Okay, but we realize also that there isn't any way of fixating the mind at all. But the peace of God is, it still feels like a condition, but it's this perfectly smoothed out condition. Smoothed out evaluations are all smoothed out. We're not trying to figure out how to induce a non-existent quality of the mind to help us. Okay, but everything feels like the perfect medicine to us. Everything feels like this. We've already got the perfect medicine from everything that we experience. We already have it. So peace of God is the goal. Not hanging out with Jesus. That's not the goal. So somehow Jesus was like incentivizing our practice somehow. In saying this, he's put us under some sort of pressure. You know, a lot of people. I don't want to say too much. The world is right now in a decision time, and I don't want to kibitz too much. You know, like the lawyer has to let the case go to the jury at some point. Y'all have to make a decision, right? Yeah, you have to make a decision. Are you going to go with a profane culture, classless, materialistic, profane culture, or more of a class-based, reverential culture, which is designed to help you practice in a steady, effective way towards diminishing the fear levels in regard to the peace of God? You're experiencing the peace of God. So Jesus would say to us, meeting him, I said, well, that's no big deal. What's a big deal is the peace of God in your practice. Your practice is what's a big deal. So Jesus is shifting the emphasis off of him onto our practice. You see, it's our practicing that's important. That's more important than meeting Jesus. Okay, more important than the Dharma Kings is our practice. It's more important. They only exist in a functional way for us in terms of helping us towards right practice and making that the goal. Okay, that's the goal. So associate with me is not the goal. That's not the goal for anyone. It's right practice is the goal. Which means steady practice, which means steady effort, which means diminishing your fear levels. Okay. Fear levels not towards me, but towards the peace of God. Okay? Towards the peace of God. That's your goal. So it's between you and the peace of God and your mind, the dynamics that we're talking about here. You have to work out, diminish your fear levels. Don't try to get somebody else to do it for you. That'll never work. Because that's right back into trying to induce some quality to fixate the mind. We keep slipping back into that easily. We're so used to focusing totally on that we've been so focused on that for so long. We've got to find a way. We've got to find a way. So our habits are overwhelmingly towards trying to find some way to induce that some hope for quality in our mind to emerge with the power to fixate our mind. That's overwhelmingly, we've been fixated on that effort. So it's quite difficult for us to start dropping that effort and fixation. The fear arises, fear of the abyss arises, like, I might stop hallucinating. But really, we don't stop hallucinating. The Holy Spirit's there with the peace of God, which is also hallucination. So the Holy Spirit has that peace of God for us. And if we decide to stop hallucinating immediately, with imperceptible gentleness, the peace of God is there for us, which is also a hallucination, but it's the final hallucination. It's the hallucination that frees us from the fear of dropping hallucination. Okay, it is. Because we're able to stop evaluating. We just have one evaluation, wow. And so we don't feel like an abyss of like, there's nothing to evaluate. It must be an abyss. So yeah, so there's no way that you can stop hallucinating and feel fear without the Holy Spirit immediately giving us the peace of God. That's its job. So it monitors every single one of us perfectly to make sure that should we be willing to drop hallucination. Every time I've been willing to drop hallucination, the peace of God was just there without any sort of gap at all. No gap at all. No gap. That's what happens. That's what happens. But you cannot make it happen without practicing diminishing your fear levels, you know. And to allow it to remain really requires us to work so much diligently. So it's really a culture of practice is what we're aiming for. And if you accept a culture of practice, in one lifetime you'll be able to do it. And if you, you know, don't push it quite hard enough, well, maybe in one more. But culture of practice really is designed for us to really succeed and be liberated from the fear of the abyss and the hideous attempt to induce, you know, fixation of the mind through creating this very insanely profane dream of fixation, you know. It's just a dream of fixation to try and induce what we hope is the king and queen, the god of fixation, to pray, like it enough to say, wow, I love what you're doing so much. I'm going to be the god of this, and I will stabilize your mind so this will remain permanent. That's what we have been aiming at. That's what we've been aiming at. So this solves the problem of the way that people have been relating to God. It seems so odd. It seems bizarre. Right? Again, they've just taken the label God, affixed it to this vain, forlorn hope that there's some power that can fixate the mind, and have been vainly worshiping this hoped-for, non-existent power in the name of God. You know, very profane thing to do, isn't it? It certainly is. Not to say trying to work on a profane materialistic culture, that's also very profane. Okay, both are. Both attempts are very profane. Totally delusional. But we're keep hoping and hoping in vain. It is possible, it's possible. Any day, you know, God's going to fixate this hallucination in my mind, and then I won't feel this insecurity anymore. And then I can finally enjoy my new creation. This is what we hope for. And that will never happen. Will never happen. So we have to accept the peace of God instead of our hallucination. Instead of hallucinating the absence of God, we accept the Holy Spirit's hallucination of hallucinating the presence of God. Yet it still feels like an evaluation and a condition. Be still or aware, like this is a condition, which is fine. We're not trying to transcend that at this point at all. The truth is that, like the Dharma kings, like Ramaharshi, he came for some who are very, very advanced in Hindu culture. of this caste-based system and their ability to practice very diligently. But even then, not many were helped that much. But to transfer this, you know, he's talking about going to the ultimate witness, the light that is actually both the subject, the object, and the seeing, the seer, the seen, and the seeing. Beyond even that, seems to skip over the peace of God experience, jump directly. But he may be speaking of the peace of God. I'm not sure exactly. Sometimes it's difficult to tell. But we are in no way. But really, you couldn't stay in this world if you were experiencing ultimate freedom. But they have their ways of expressing it. But in no way are we ready for that. It's foolish to think that we have sorted everything out, the rest of us. We haven't even remotely sorted it out, most of us. Really, the peace of God is still a hallucination. This is what Jesus tells us. So I'm very much aware of what Jesus has to say, and very much in agreement with it in my own practicing. And again, he brings in the Holy Spirit and tells us the Holy Spirit will provide this hallucination of the peace of God for us, so we don't have to, we don't feel we're giving up hallucination, which is our great fear. So if you want to try to give up hallucination, the difficulty of the path is just extraordinarily difficult. But with Jesus' way, he says, don't need to do that at all. He's made it so much easier. Well, God did. He said God provided the Holy Spirit for us. The real God created to give us this like intermediate step so we can set down our attempt to induce fixation, be willing to give up hallucination and evaluation, but at the same time ease into this by an intermediate step of one last condition, one last evaluation, and this then easily acclimatizes us to reality. Easily acclimatizes us. It's acclimatization sort of thing, a familiarization. So I'm still not exactly sure about the Eastern teachings and then Jesus' teaching, if they're exactly the same or not. Usually it seems like, yeah, they are. But they don't explain it as clearly as Jesus has explained it. That is for sure. Jesus has really explained it very, very clearly about what to expect and why we're doing it. So I've really been trained in that sort of clarity. And this is not prohibitively difficult for any of us if we're just willing to do steady practice. Crucify ourselves, our expectations every day. We expect a certain amount of fear towards setting down hallucination. And so if we don't have that level of fear, we get really frightened. So what we have to do is reduce that level of fear every day. And even that, just a little reduction in that, gets us very jittery. Very jittery. So there's no way we can just see through this intellectually and be done with it. No chance. It's useless. Explanation in this regard is useless. It's only practice that actually does it for us. Explanation by itself won't get it done for us at all. And in that type of culture, they know that if you're not practicing, you don't have access. And even if you are practicing, it's up to the guru to determine whether they want to give you a little bit of access or not. It's not something you need to think about or focus on, like, how do I get access? No, you just practice, and that's your life. That's your caste. That's your class in life is one as a practicer. Okay. And you shouldn't even aspire to a higher class. And that way, if you just practice very diligently, then perhaps you will be elevated into a slightly higher situation. But that's not your goal. It's not really your goal. That's just a pragmatic thing to help the Dharma kings out. But that's not your goal. Your goal is the peace of God. That's it. Once you have that, you're free of the vast, this hideous staging of hope and fear, which we call heaven and hell. Heaven and hell is one dream of hope, really, of hoping we can fixate the mind. And of course, fearing that we can't. We have to account for the fear, like it. We feel so fear, we feel insecure. So our dream has to be one, a stratified dream of layers and levels, labeling the ultimate, the dream of success as heaven, and the worst of the dream as failure, as hell. And within that is this massive play of hope and fear between those two polarities. That's how the dream has to arise. It has to arise that way to account for both our desire to have it, to stabilize the mind, and this feeling within us that we can't do it. And then our desperate hope that we have to somehow find that which can do it. So then we have devised all sorts of rituals and worship and begging and, you know, God, I'll do this. I'll do this if you will. I'll die if you're willing to fixate the mind or something. Like, I'll do all this, worship you and all this stuff. But, you know, worshiping what doesn't exist doesn't do any good. What can never exist. We're not able to create a new quality of mind just through industrious endeavor, industrious dreaming. Not at all. Because the mind's already set as perfect freedom. There's no other quality. It's perfectly free. There's no quality of fixation in the mind. There's no capability of that at all. So it's utterly futile, what we've been attempting. Totally futile. And so that futility, we feel that we dream that that's hell. And then the hope that it's not futile is what we call heaven. You see that? So we have to, instead of clearly seeing what's going on, we keep structuring this as if it's a stage. We still have hope. We still are trying to make it work. So we say, yeah, well, there's a hellish realm. That's where futility, those who pursue a futile path, that's where you reside. And there's a heavenly realm, those who do pursue this in the right way, then they get to dwell there. So we keep incentivizing ourselves with this dream of heaven and hell. But it's just one dream. There's no real layers or levels in that whatsoever. There's no actual heaven like the way we're dreaming it, or hell like we're dreaming it. No, that's how we're trying to keep incentivizing ourselves to keep trying to induce this non-existent quality of power that in our mind that can fixate our mind. That's how we just keep trying to incentivize it. All futile. But then again, if we think, well, we give up this dream and then, you know, it's an abyss. No, we'll have the peace of God first, and then we'll have all value everywhere always. After we're familiar with the peace of God, it means, you know, total fullness everywhere always. All value everywhere always. R is to simply choose and experience. So don't worry about, like, well, how do I fit in? You fit in as a practitioner, as a practicer. That's the only way to fit in. Now, there's a few that might be given some designation, having practiced so long and so diligently, they're able to perhaps get the accept the peace of God, or very close to it, something like that. And they may here be in helping us with this. So they're in a different class. You know, don't aim for that class. That's just something that's kind of been pragmatically given to them to help out. Your class is that of a practicer. So just accept that. Takes the pressure off. And you should have no desire, really, to come in contact with anyone above you. No real desire for that. When it happens, you'll realize that you've been incentivized to practice even more diligently. That's what it's all about. Longchenpa suggested to me I might want to start considering myself as a Dharma prince. But I said, okay, I'll consider, but I'm not going to let that interfere with my practice. You know, as long as it doesn't interfere with my practicing. So I've just kept practicing, and even, you know, more so than ever. I still said, well, you know, it's possible. I'll have to see, you know, how that plays out. But, you know, still, it's my practicing, because the goal is not some title. The goal is the peace of God. Okay, it's not some title. And yet titles are helpful to incentivize a reverent culture, a practicing culture. That's helpful. We want to see that it's successful. We want to know that it's possible. That's very important. You have to have those in the world who have done it. Otherwise, you're not gonna keep working at it enough. But so to have those who have succeeded in the world, and yet you don't want to feel like that you could come in contact with them, because it's like, you know, it's too frightening. So you have to have both. You have to have those who have succeeded and a system that of buffering, okay? Of buffering, which is a reverent culture. It's like priests, you don't casually converse with them. You bless, you know, blessings of the day, blessings of God upon you, Father. If she comes up, the priest is, they like to come around. They're trying to have a real casual atmosphere in the Catholic Church now, I think, which is really bad. It's the wrong direction entirely. It's leading to materialism and a profane culture. So the priest was going along and shakes everyone's hands before Mass. And so we happened to go to our seats, and he was right there by our seats. And so he turned around and saw us and says, oh, hi, how are you? Nice to see you. And we're both saying, hi, how you doing? You know, how's your soccer game? So did your team win? He says, well, you know, they won. You know, casually talk about sports and stuff. But for me, I shook his hand. I said, blessings of God upon you, Father. And he was like very surprised and even kind of, I think, a little bit offended. Like, he says, that's not really the tone we're trying to set here. He says, well, blessings of God upon you too. But he's like shocked. You know, he said, that's old style, he's saying. He said, that's old, you're old style, old school. No, I'm not old school. I'm right school, you know. I'm wise school. It's not old school and new school. It's reverent, effective, wise school and profane, ineffective, feudal school. That's the choice we have. It's not old and new school at all. Profane culture has been around forever. That's what doesn't work. You might call that's old. You know, that's all. Futility is boring, really. Boring between boring, what doesn't work and is boring, and between what does work and it's really very interesting. Success is very interesting, actually. Very compelling. You just say, wow, this is working. This is tremendous. That's amazing. It's amazing culture, actually. It's a wow culture. It's really between bow culture. No, you got, what can you say? You know, feudal culture and wow culture. Maybe Mao culture and wow culture. Mao meaning, you know, flattened out, communistic, materialistic culture. Super egalitarian, equalitarian, materialistic, dystopian culture. A Maoist culture and a wowist culture. That's the choice. One that's feudal, one that's super effective. So it's not old school and new school at all. That's a wrong wait, because then it makes you think like you're being progressive. No, we're not being progressive, and the world is regressive. We choose between what's regressive and what works. Profane culture is just a totally feudal, regressive culture. It doesn't work. That's all. It's been tried over and over and over and over again. So it's very boring. So, yeah, I don't even feel welcome now in what's supposed to be the bastion of reverent cultures. The priests are trying to get you to be casual. Talk about sports with them. Let's not talk about Jesus. Let's talk about soccer. Let's talk about this. Let's be chatty about mundane things, about mundane profane things. You're meeting supposedly the man that can turn the Eucharist into the body and blood of Christ, and you're talking about profane mundane things. What in the world is that? Where's the buffer there? You know, that is just crazy collapse of the church, a collapse of that wowist culture, you know, that the culture that works. It's just in absolute collapse. I didn't even go up to the bishop, you know. I had too much reverence for him when he was in the church. Other people, the girls go up gaily, "Hi, Bishop. Oh, how are you?" You know, I was like, I'm not going to say a word to him unless he turns to me and wants to greets me. I'm not going to go up and greet the bishop. Are you kidding? That just should not be done. That's profane. Now, I feel he's a very good bishop. He has an aura of great peace and gentleness to him. So I did not greet him. Some people went up to and asked for his blessings, but I have too much reverence for him to say anything or approach him at all. And he should understand that. He should be looking for those who have reverence, not for those who are profane. And if you see someone with genuine reverence, "I'm not approaching you," then he should come up to them and you know, he said, "Blessings of Christ upon you," or something like that. And then you take it like that. And then he might just spend some quiet time with you, just like that. That's how it should be done. You shouldn't speak to a bishop, let alone a priest, unless the priest initiates it. So you don't initiate contact or dialogue with those who are part of the structure of a reverent society. You're quiet. You sit in your seat and you're quiet. And if they come up to you, you stay quiet and let them say what they want to say to you. And then you take it in and you listen to what they say. Just remain quiet. That's really the way it should be done, is you just remain quiet. You're under no obligation to have dialogue at all. If they want to give you a blessing and boost, then they're capable. They know what they're doing. They know how to do that. You're there to receive the blessing in silence and let it sink in. And stick with your practice of wow. You're there to wow whatever they say. So I've been studying the church for quite some time, directly immersed in it, and seeing the collapse of it into a profane institution. It's the church is finished, actually. Jesus is back. It means the church is no more. It's profane. It's very profane right now. And they keep reenacting their belief that God so loved the world that he decided to fixate it. To fixate our little staging, a little stage that we've set up here, the universe, our little stage, that God finally decided, "Oh, I love this place, man. Look at this. What the, this is right down my alley, you know. Death and sickness and aging and impermanence and time and space and process and form and images and concepts. Oh, wow, this is great." You know, I'm just being facetious, of course. We're just hoping that this will induce a non-existent characteristic we have to fixate the mind. So they keep reenacting their hope and fixation there, is all they're doing. Yeah, God, they say God fixated, God so loved the world, he decided to fixate himself as a body. And now you can eat the body and the blood so that you can be fixated too. This will fixate your mind. That's the purpose of the Eucharist, is to fixate our mind. They're hoping it will fixate their mind. That's not my goal. I don't take the Eucharist because my goal is to realize you cannot fixate the mind. It's impossible. There's no capability of doing that whatsoever, which then makes us get dread of the abyss. We're going to drop hallucination. Holy cow. Which means we got to turn to the Holy Spirit and the peace of God and put our faith in the Holy Spirit. We have to put our faith in the Holy Spirit. Not in Jesus, not in eating the body of Jesus, but if Jesus said, "Put your faith in the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will reveal everything that needs to be revealed to you and train you in right practice and right." Yeah, of course that's what he said when he left. He didn't say, "Worship me." He said, "Put your faith in the Holy Spirit." He didn't say, "Make a religion centered upon my death and all this stuff." He said, "Listen to the Holy Spirit." So that's what I've done. I don't worship Jesus. I have great love and reverence for him, yes. But I listen to the Holy Spirit, grace of God, as he told us to do. And the ones who didn't listen to that, they're, you know, continuing in very, you know, bizarre attempts to induce fixation of the mind. And they don't know how to practice properly at all. They don't practice properly. been working out so much, my knee is aching. But what could I do? I just have to keep strengthening my body overall, and that this achy knee has helped me out greatly to avoid all sorts of troubles. Sometimes, you know, a little bit of a thorn in the flesh is helpful. Really, it is. So the blood of Christ means the suffering that can come upon us in this practice, so that we accept, voluntarily select to suffer, crucifying our expectations, our fear levels, to lessen them every day, that we won't be interested in the other sufferings. The other sufferings will pass us by. Passover will pass us by. We're already disciplined in how to suffer properly. Okay? Passover, passing us by. Instead, people take it to mean we've already found the way to fixate the mind, so we don't need the other ways. Where we've got the answer. God already agreed to fixate our mind if we're just loyal to death. Yeah, that's what they believe. All we have to do is be, the priest said last Sunday, he said, whole baptism, whole purpose is to consecrate you to death. And that's what the purpose is. That means you're trying to say to this non-existent, hope for characteristic to fixate the mind that, hey, you know, we believe you already agreed to fixate the mind as long as we're loyal to death, that you would love that so much that we're loyal to death that you will then agree to fixate the mind. This is just a vain hope. It's a vain hope. I've never been baptized. I'm not going to be baptized into consecrated to death. No. I'm not going to believe that eating the Eucharist will fixate my mind. The mind cannot be fixated in any way. Even though we believe it is, we're just dreaming a dream of fixation to try and induce this power to fixate our mind. It's a totally vain dream also. So I've never really worshipped this dream. No, I don't worship the dream. But it's beautiful. I mean, it's qualities of beauty here, right? I acknowledge in that and appreciate it. That's our own creativity. The God-given creativity is used to try and, in this dream, sure, we could. But the dream the Holy Spirit has for us, the hallucination of the peace of God, that's, Jesus says, that's way better. It's way better. Now, I had this experience several nights ago where I closed my eyes and I became aware of all these very fine lines of light in my visual field with my eyes closed. Super straight. It was super straight, actually. They were all totally straight. Super close together. But I was able to see that. I said, what is this? I've never seen this before. Now, it is a very interesting consideration. I thought they were kind of dim. But the question is, were they dim or were they just extremely fine? And so I concluded that maybe they're just dim and I need to make them brighter. But it could be that they weren't really dim at all. It's just they were super fine. Gossamer-like strands of light. And that I could actually see this all the time. Jesus says we'll actually start seeing very fine light, this dance of beautiful light. I've never directly experienced that. But I wonder if this is a precursor, kind of like showing me this is coming now. And I kind of gradually sort of turned away from it because I said, wow, it's just not bright enough for me. It's not bright. Is it not bright or is it just super fine? See, that's... And as such, it's super gentle, had a super gentle feel because it was so gossamer-like. So gossamer-like. And was it really dim? Ah, it's a very good question to ask myself, right? Very good. I was thinking, how do I make it brighter? but maybe I don't need to make it brighter. Maybe Jesus says it's the dance that these threads, the light does, that is so beautiful. And it's not like the blaring brightness of it. It's not blaringly bright. Very gentle, very subtle and gentle. But it's the gorgeous dance that they do. So I didn't see the dance. They were all perfectly straight in front of me. But maybe that was just letting me know, get used to the quality of these super, super fine filament, gossamer-like filaments of light. In sort of in the mind's eye, I was aware of this. And then maybe at some point they will start dancing. Be nice. He says it's a dance is just so enchanting, the most enchanting dance imaginable. You can, that's what he says. So I'll take him at his word. You know, I haven't experienced it yet, but if it happens, I'll say, yeah, well, that's what Jesus said would happen. So it may be that is an aspect of the peace of God, that we're so used to imagining action, right? That without some sort of play of light like that, we might feel, you know, like we're missing something. Because we have the play of light is going on continuously, right, in here. The sun, the clouds, everything's hitting, bounce the light. What we see is just reflected light off of all everything. We don't see the things themselves. We're seeing light being reflected into our perception. We're not seeing a tree, okay? We're seeing light. We're always seeing light. We're not seeing things at all, actually. What we call things are just like mirrors that bounce light off themselves. Reflect light off themselves. Everything is just, it's a hall of mirrors. It's not really a, you know, we call these plants. What do you mean plants? These are mirrors for us. We're not seeing the essence of what it is. It's just mirrors reflecting light. Everything's a mirror just reflecting light. But everything may have more of an essence to it, which is the spaciousness. Its essence is spaciousness. But spaciousness does not reflect light, sunlight. There's no reflective quality of intrinsic spaciousness at all. I've experienced that intrinsic spaciousness. I said, oh, so there are all these mirrors moving around, but the mirrors themselves are just intrinsic spaciousness. They have that quality to them, which has nothing to do with reflected light at all. So you can move beyond reflected light, a solar reflected light, by the vision of intrinsic spaciousness. And this just arises when you keep chipping away at your fear of the peace of God, which is a huge fear. I've been chipping away at it for a long time. Really 48 years of intense, ever since I was 12 years old. I've never had any cataclysmic breakthrough at all. It's just been gentle. When I willing to let go of my fear a little bit and trust in letting go of hallucination, that there's no way to fixate the mind, then the gentle peace of God is just imperceptibly present. Then I think, what did I do? What did I do? Meaning, how do I get out of this? There's nothing to evaluate, you know. I'm not used to this. Well, of course we're not used to it. It's frustrating because you want to get used to it, but how do you get used to it if you turn away from it and abandon it? You can't. So I say, don't let me turn to abandonment. But if we abandon it, what can it do? So there must be some, and we can't, must be some way, well, practice, and just keep practicing. And one day, it'll be easy, just like I couldn't do a single push-up a while ago, not even one, not even close. I tried to do it, I just, oh, there's no way. So I can't do this, even remotely do this. I didn't think I could ever do it. It seems so difficult. Now I can do them. I tried a couple days ago. I just tried to do a really super great one, and it's like easy. I just like, wow. I now, but my shoulders are tired, right? I'm achy. My arms and shoulders are achy. But I could do it perfectly. And I just had the capability to do it. So where'd that come from? Well, a lot of hard work. A lot of hard work. Doing push-ups, gas station push-ups almost every day. Doing core workout almost every day. Just a massive amount of hard work. And then what I'm able to do? A perfect push-up. But I didn't even try. I've only tried a few times because it's, you know, I don't make that direct goal. It's pretty difficult because you get discouraged. Just keep working out. Just keep working out. Eventually say, well, eventually I feel like I'll probably get there. Eventually, if I just really keep working out, I'll probably get there. And I feel that way of the peace of God. I will get there. I feel that way. But I don't think about it directly. I just keep working on, you know, chipping away at my fear. That's all. That's the right attitude to have. And I can tell if somebody doesn't have that attitude. I can tell. I can feel it. They've got it somehow reversed. They want to keep evaluating, you know, keep getting some evaluation from some guru. Like, am I there yet? If I just do it right, am I there? That's the wrong attitude to have. You just forget about that. You know how to practice. It's easy. Just keep doing it. But people are think they're too much of a hurry because what they really want is they want to get you to fixate their mind. They think, if I can please you and you know, show that I'm worthy, can you fixate my mind for me, please? I'm really scared, and this is going to take too long. I'm never going to succeed at this practice. Now that's, you know, totally wrong position to have, and a lot of us have that. I can't do the impossible. Can't fixate your mind. Can't fixate anyone's mind. No possibility of that. And as far as the peace of God, I can't give you that either. That's the Holy Spirit. It's the Holy Spirit. Only the Holy Spirit can give that peace of mind. That's why gurus going around giving Shaktipat and stuff. I don't like that. The guru can't give you peace of God. It's the Holy Spirit. It's the grace of God. The guru may help when you're ready to have a glimpse of the peace of God. The guru might be able to reassure you, but that can be done internally. You don't need an external guru for that. That just happens automatically. Some guru will show up in your dreams and help you move forward, like Longchenpa did for me. Yeah, I don't know, this whole idea about the externalization of the hierarchy, I have my doubts about it, because it seems as though what they're hoping for is we can create this beautiful equalitarian society and culture, and the gurus all come here to help us do that. That's not our goal at all. This world is a dream. Our goal is the peace of God, and then to set down this world and universe all together. We're for freedom. We're not conditioned in any way. We don't have a universe conditioning the mind. So the idea of the great masters coming into the world so that they can then smooth out this distribution of food and medical care and build this wonderful great society, what is that? That's a socialist utopian dystopian dream. That you know, like theosophy, that's what theosophy speaks of, and the United Nations is based on theosophy. That's their goal. I mean, the way I look at it, that's crazy. That's profane, very profane. That doesn't work at all. They say Maitreya is coming back to make sure that he's going to set up, make sure everyone has equal amount of food, equal amount of money. Nobody's wanting for good house and, you know, running water and a good hygiene. And we'll build this, you know, very equal culture where nobody's suffering. What is that? Suffering is good for us. You know, it drives us back towards truth. What is that? It's a socialist utopian ideal, which is horrible. That's Antichrist. That's anti the plan of God, in my opinion, the way I look at it. Very much so. We should feel the insecurity of this dream and use it to motivate us towards the peace of God. So we can stop dreaming altogether. We don't need the dream anymore. You see, we don't need it anymore. We don't need the dream of heaven and hell. The dream, our dream in trying to fixate the mind to have a new creation will always be a dream of heaven and hell. You can't have the masters change that in any way. It's impossible. They're really believing that the masters can accomplish the impossible where we can't. Or they'll show us how to accomplish the impossible. That is really antichrist. Crazy, delusional. Now there may be two schools to theosophy, you know, a more sane one and one that's very insane. Externalization is possible, but only when we accept a class-based reverential culture, which buffers us from them. We're properly buffered, and we realize our role is to be quiet and practice, that we have the right to be poor. I mean, don't take away my right to be poor. If I want to be, don't take away my right to be deprived. Don't take away my right to be sick. I mean, I was talking with a friend who's living with cancer, and it was very interesting what he had to say. He says, you know, this is my. I texted him once. I said, this is your great opportunity. You know, this is your opportunity. You know, go for it. And he basically told me that. I said, I feel this is a great, great opportunity for me. It's because I got no choice now. He told me that. I feel like I have no choice but to really go all in on looking at my mind, looking at life, looking at my mind. And I say, that's beautiful, man. That's the greatest thing ever, to feel like you have no choice. That's what helped me, is I realized I had no choice. So don't deprive me of sickness and suffering and deprivation and difficulty. What I need a lot of times, not also don't deprive me of wealth and riches and a higher class designation if I'm successful with the peace of God. Don't deprive me of that either. I don't want some leveled out world, a culture where we can't use these motivations. I mean, but desperation is a super great motivation, and feeling you have no choice is fantastic. And someone else told me his father turned toward God when he was about ready to die of cancer after a long, terrible cancer. He finally said, you know, God, I don't have it right. I turn to you, and you need to straighten me out because I don't know what I'm doing. He finally did. And his son said, that's the greatest thing that ever happened. The cancer is the greatest thing that ever happened in his life, which was true, because he said he was a very profane man, a very profane man. Very proud, arrogant, and profane. And the cancer finally humbled him to the point he says, you know what, I don't have all the answers. I need to reevaluate this. I need help. You know, may the grace of God be upon me. So that was super great for him. We don't want to cure all illnesses. What is that? Suffering is here in the world is often our greatest ally. And we got this stupid materialistic society that, you know, he's taking morphine, my friend, but, you know, he needs it. I understand. The pain was so bad, you know, it was just getting him down. Now he feels more confident. But, of course, morphine ruins your appetite and you starve to death. So, you know, it's not a good thing that way. But at least attitude-wise, he's taking it the right way. He's trying to. I hope he really does. He told me, I am totally desperate, and I got no choice but to reevaluate my life and to be serious. I mean, I'm desperate. I got no choice. So, very good. And he's willing to do chemo. That's fine. I got no problem with that. He wants to live. He wants to live, and so you can get well that way. That's a way to get well. It's a change of heart, a change of mind. So this hell, I mean, you want hell is where there's no, is where you're still completely deluded, but they try to take suffering away from you, and desperation and poverty and stuff. Your motivation, they try to demotivate you. Okay, that's bad. And that's one way of motivation. The other way of motivation is for those who are really high class, wealth, privilege, all that stuff. Don't take that away because that motivates us also. So really, the carrot and the stick both motivate us. Sure, I'm motivated by the pure lands, by the death-free realms, by the, the all the great things that the Dharma kings have, and the peace of God. And you could be motivated in both ways, but they want to flatten out and have neither one of those. They want to remove incentive and motivation from us. These are those arrogant ones who believe that this plan of this dream of time, space, process, and form is going to work, and they'll be able to finally fixate the mind. That's what they believe. And so they are completely deluded. There's no way to do that. And so they think they're building the new age, and it's they're doing the right thing. No, they're doing totally the wrong thing that way. Totally the wrong thing. Now, we don't have to suffer. We can be motivated in a positive way. That is possible, sure. Once, if we're practicing right, then we're inducing suffering on ourselves. We don't need external suffering upon us at all. We don't need external poverty or deprivation. So we're depriving ourselves every day of our set of expectations. So once you learn how to suffer properly, purposefully, you don't need all this other suffering, and you can go to a beautiful realm and be motivated, in a positive way by that as you continue to your practice of suffering through the death of your expectations. You see how that works? But this profane, humanistic, materialistic, consumer-driven, medical, let's treat everything with, let's take away all suffering. What a hell that is. I mean, that's really hell right there. I mean, that's terrible. So I've suffered so much in my life, it's ridiculous, but it was something I was willing to go through, and use it properly. Use it properly. I still felt like, I'm fortunate in some way because I'm able to get my attention in the right direction. This has really gotten my attention. The suffering really has my attention. And it's off of fun, having fun. I have a focus better than having fun. You see, that's so important. Yeah, we don't rule fun out entirely, because that's too much for us. But you realize you got a way more important focus than fun, which is how to suffer consciously and purposefully in the right way to ultimately, chip away at your fear. And get the peace of God. That's way better than fun. So the Rip Curl Pro wasn't on today for the men. And I said, that's fine, because I have this practice I can do. That means great, more time for me to practice. I don't even know if I'll watch it, but I'm interested in it because of Bell's Beach. Bell's Beach in Australia, I think it's Victoria, Australia, really southern Australia. I think Australia has what, New South Wales, and I think there's Victoria, right, on the real southern area of southwest of Australia. Queensland, New South Wales, and then I'm not sure what the other territories are. The great, the great central territory, the Outback territory, and then Western Australia. It's cold, the waters. I didn't know this. I said, Bell's Beach is like, I always heard this, like, this is the mecca of surfing, Bell's Beach. Well, it's the oldest championship surfing tournament in the world. Laguna Beach has one that's not a pro tournament. It's an amateur kind of tournament. It's longer, but it's been running for a long time, Bell's Beach. I don't know, 50 years or more, something like that. I think it started in 74. So 84, 94, 104, 40, 44 years or, it's been going on something like that, maybe 44 years. And it's, so it's this iconic place. I I've heard of it, Pelsby. I thought, oh wow, this is some amazing place, some dream place. I don't know. I had no idea. And so I really am interested to see what it's about. So I finally looked up pictures of it and watched some video. I've still not watched any video of people surfing it. I got to get into that. But I was like, what? It's just, this is it? I had some magnificent idea of what it was. I'll tell you what's magnificent is Snapper Rocks in Australia. That's a cool venue. But the waves in Australia in general, Snapper's Rock, Margaret River, and Bells Beach, as far as tournaments, they're not that, you know, I expected way more. They're kind of, I don't know, Bells is kind of mushy. It's kind of a mushy right point break. It's not that big, and it's overrated. I think who was it? One of the Australian four-time champs, was it Mark Richard or something like that? He said it's way overrated, most overrated wave in the world. But it's got this iconic status, and the beach, you know, there's like a long stairway that goes into kind of a real high bluff. And it's just this high bluff that's got all this vegetation that goes down near the beach, and you have to go way down the stairway, and then there's just kind of this nondescript beach. There's a beach there, and then there's just like a point break that goes out, and there's just like some kind of mushy walls that come in, and it's like, wow, was I underwhelmed by Bell's Beach. Holy cow. It's way out in the sticks, way out in the middle of nowhere. I thought it was like set in some like beautiful city, and it was like making, you know, just huge crowds there, and surf, like a road of surf shops and everything. There's nothing there. There's nothing there. Except a staircase and a car park, I guess. It's out in the sticks. Wow. So that really blew my mind. And if it's a really big swell, I guess it can be pretty nice, but so can a lot of places. Yeah, right? But if there's not a big swell, it's really not that much to speak about. So, I mean, we're spoiled by watching Pipeline. Pipeline's the best wave in the world, and I'm so used to seeing that. You see other waves, it's like, what? It's not very good. There's really not that many good waves in the world, if you really think about it, in terms of consistency. And we see these pictures, but these people are hunting waves all over the world, and it's certain swells, and they only break that way occasionally. Kind of disappointing, the waves of the world, actually. So far, I've been underwhelmed. But they say Margaret River is really, really powerful. Though I guess I understand it's possible. It's a deep ocean wave, massive volume, moving fast out there. And even though it doesn't barrel up, they say one of the commentators is a really great surfer. Said he went out in 5-foot wave, and it 5-foot wave white hit him, and it cartwheeled him 3 times and then dragged him a long ways. He said, "Man, is that wave powerful!" All right, take his word at it. Word for it, it's powerful. It's a deep ocean wave. It's different than a point break kind of, really. So the pros, yeah, we want to see them on more dicey, harrowing waves, you know, that are just, there's a lot of risk in terms of them, you know, getting crushed, and we want to see them really be put to the test. It's like golf pros, you want to see them play Augusta where you can, like, you know, if you miss the putt, it's going off the green into the water or something. I mean, where they're really put to the test. You want to, so a lot of people want to see these pros really put to the test. But I don't mind them surfing these waves, because in some way they're put to the test, in that they have to make it look like the wave's great, even though maybe it isn't. So you see their artistry and creativity at work. And that's something to really appreciate, because most waves of the world are not so great. But they're able to make it look like, wow, what a great wave this is. Whereas most of us get on that, it doesn't look like anything very nice at all. So they have to learn how to generate speed on these waves that aren't so fast. And it takes great line and weight balance and the right board and just a lot of factors they have to put in. That's great surfing right there. So that should be rewarded. great surfing in that way. It's not just the aerials and, you know, the stuff getting barreled and things. A lot of waves don't allow for that. So, a little bit, you know, a little bit of fun, but I always say, well, I got something way better than that to do, which is right practice. I live for that, and you need to live for that too. We all need to. We need to have the, in a culture of practice, we with a mutual admiration of those who practice, and you know, and the guru in me bows to the guru in you, meaning the guru of your own practice, meaning you have skillful means that'll lead to the peace of God. The final step of evaluation, condition, hallucination, the hallucination, which allows us to set down all hallucinating, totally set it down, not destroy it, because we can always choose to do it again. We can always imagine the absence of God again if we want to, but hopefully we won't do that for a while, you know. Knowing how it plays out, we're gonna get wise about it, you know. It's, the dream of hope and fear and infinite regress of time. You know, when we think of, believe in time, we believe in all time. We don't believe just in the next moment. We believe in the endless past and future as the way to induce fixation in the mind. So when we're looking at time, we use the belief in time to try to induce this an imaginary reclusive characteristic of mind to come out of its hiding and say, oh, I love this infinite time. Yeah, infinite fixation of mind here into time. Ah, okay, I will now fixate the mind, because you're showing me how loyal you are to this idea of fixating the mind. So now I can do that. So, but time, it's just an inducement, you see. And this is the trick. Really, there's just this one little trick of mind that is tripping us up, which is really time. That's the major inducement that we're using, Jesus says. That's the major one. And it's the toughest one, because the idea, our belief in time, is right in the now, in the moment, actually. But it's an idea of infinite absence of now, both stretching in the past and stretching in the future. But that idea is still just this one moment in the now. And so time doesn't really exist at all, except as this imaginary inducement that we're trying to use to induce, to lure this hope for care quality out of our mind, out of hiding, so it will fixate the mind. It's a lure. It's a lure. But we've become entranced by this lure ourselves, believing in the lure, believing it actually has extension to it. It doesn't have any extension to it. It doesn't fixate the mind at all. The mind's not fixated. We're using this lure of belief in fixation, but time doesn't really extend at all into the future or the past. There is no future or past at all. There's no fixation of the mind. For mind to be real, the mind would have to be fixated. For time to be real, and it's not. I had that experience once where I woke up and I was dreaming of like a million years of time passing, and it felt like I was in this, I'd been going through this time of a million years, and it felt like so long, vastly long experience. And I woke up and I said, wait a minute, if I've been sitting here, lying here in bed, and this is a dream, then only like a few, I realized I just dozed off, only a few moments had passed, and yet it felt like a million years had passed. And then I realized, hey, wait a minute, we're just making this up. This is just a feeling that we're feeling this to try to induce something, aren't we? So that's sort of that wised me up a bit. So, oh, wow. So I'm getting more wised up now by saying, hey, wait, this is just an inducement. We're pretending that we're in time just to show our goodwill to this hope for power, you know, of the mind to fixate the mind. Say, look at this goodwill. Look how much we love time. We're immersed in it. We're committed to it for billions of years. Yeah, but we may say we're committed to it right now, but there isn't any billion years yet. That would only happen if the mind was fixated. So, in other words, we can drop a billion years this instant. It's still just a hallucination. It's a hallucination of time. It's not real at all. We can drop a billion years in the past and a billion years in the future this very instant. Of course, to do that, we'd have to admit it's just a gesture on our goodwill gesture of imagining, just trying to imagine, say, you know, we're willing to imagine time to show how much we really want it. You know, we think we gotta show how much we want it, fixated mind, by imagining it. But it's just our imagination, which is hallucination, which is subject to instantly dropping this belief in time. Instantly. So we have this feeling that we're trying to use to show our goodwill, like a goodwill feeling. I feel like I've been living for billions of years, kind of thing. We haven't been living at all in time. As far as time-based life, it's never happened. It's just a dream of inducement that we've been having. We've been trying to induce its happening by saying, well, I'm dreaming it's happening, but what is it? Where is a dream except in the moment of the dreamer? The dream is never in anything other than the dreamer, which is always dreaming in the moment. It's not fixated. It's always dreaming from an unfixated standpoint. So time is just a mere trick of the mind, trying to trick this quality to help us, this imaginary quality to help us. We're just trying to trick it. We don't have any time. We don't have time. It's a trick of the mind. The mind's playing that, is trying to trick itself, trying to induce something out of itself which doesn't exist. It's trying to force it, trick it, you know, to get this quality of fixation that we hope we have. Doesn't work. So we keep thinking, maybe I need to trick it even more. Like, let's add even more time to this. More commitment. But our commitment is just a mental trick. There is no commitment. We don't have any commitment. It's totally imaginary. And we're just hoping, we think that this is failing because it's not tricky enough. Maybe they're seeing it. So we just gotta, you know, believe it even more, commit even more. But it's still just a mere trick, a mental trick. Easily seen through. And we can drop it in an instant. One insight settles it all. Absolutely. Super easy. But we want to make it seem like it's super difficult to incentivize, you know, to try to say, look what good, how loyal we are to your loyal subjects, God of fixating the mind. You know, we can't, you know, no, this, yeah, it's a dream, but it's like unbelievably difficult to set down because we're so loyal to it, you know. We've committed so much to it. We haven't committed anything to it except make-believe, you know. We're not committed at all. We can't. How can we commit to the impossible? How can we commit to fixating the mind? There's nothing to commit to. We're never committed. We're always totally uncommitted. But we pretend it's so difficult. Oh, we're so trapped in this and that. Oh no, when insight can't settle. How's that possible? No, we've taken so many steps of commitment, imaginary steps. We haven't really taken even one step. We can't take any step to committing to nothing, to what doesn't exist. So this kind of caught me unexpectedly. See, I saw through it for a moment. I said, oh wow, I can see how easy it is. It's like, wow, we're very close to seeing that. Wow. And we even pretend to be that the inducement is working. We make believe that too. So, oh, see there, I felt induced away from truth. I felt induced away from feeling. But we're making that feeling up. There's no such real feeling because there is no fixation happening. And there's nothing to induce to make it happen. We're just mislabeling it and believing in the labels. Look beneath the labels and nothing's happening. That's why Jesus calls it a journey beyond words. Look beneath the labels and nothing is happening. As soon as we move toward labels, automatically we have two labels. One symbolizing hope, one symbolizing fear, and then the interplay of hope and fear, which then generates more labels to show how committed we are, even more commitment, even more. It always takes more to keep playing this game. Always takes more. So we can't just rest on one label or even two labels. In order to have more, we need interplay of hope and fear. That's the motivation we use. But that's make-believe motivation too. So the whole motivational structure is just make-believe. There's no real response at all happening. We fake response. We say, oh, God is responding. Or the imaginary God of fixation is responding. I can feel the response. I see, look at these labels like and change. But we're just rearranging hope and fear to simulate response when in fact there's no response. So I just crucified my expectations here with this recognition of I sort of felt a glimpse, like I felt, whoa, this I'm right on this time issue. Wow. Wow. And so that crucified my expectations and I went into shock. I got closer to it than I expected. So now instead of trying to really get it, I now focus on the shock of having, you know, I realize my fear is much less than it was before. So it was less than I expected. So that crucified my expectations. Now I'm in shock. So let the shock sink in. Letting the shock just sink in is the death on the cross. That's what death on the cross symbolizes. You're not struggling for more life, in other words, to get more. You're accepting your death, meaning you've stopped your efforts and you're letting just the shock settle in. Letting death happen slowly. Crucifixion is a slow death. And then we then accept our fate, that's enough for now. We just died to our expectations. We don't have a new set of expectations yet, so we're sort of like in a dead zone, right? So then we lay in, next step, lay in the grave for a while. Patient non-action for a while. And that's how we practice. So I'm not expecting success or failure right now. It's just when you're laying in a tomb, no one expects you to do much, right? You're just, I think, laying there. Say, well, okay, they're laying there. They're dead. That's fine. We're not really, truly dead, but we're dead in a certain way, temporarily dead. And then our resurrection shows that it was just we had died to a certain set of expectations. Is what had happened. So those who are used to worshiping this wrongly labeled non-existent quality, hoped for quality of power to fixate our minds, which they've been labeling God, they've been worshiping that God. They hope that someone comes along, says that they know God. They say, "Oh, great! Could you talk to God and ask God to fixate my mind, please? I'm very nervous. I mean, I feel like the world might slip away from you know." Well, you know, that's ridiculous, isn't it? So they say, these spiritual masters don't exist. They don't come to me. They don't help, you know, help me fixate my mind. Well, of course not. Their goal is to let go of that unattainable goal, futile goal. I can't help anyone. I can't go to God and say, "Hey, they're worshiping really nicely. Could you please fixate their mind?" Because they assume that we're happy because our mind has been fixated. No, we're experiencing the peace of God is an intermediate step to setting down, we've set down that goal as impossible, futile. And not enough people in the world realize this. They're ignorant of it. They're so ignorant. How can we be so ignorant? Well, massive distraction. It's our own fault, you know. It's our attention. We don't have to distract our attention. We have to let our attention be guided and attracted to truth, right in the midst of where our attention has taken us, really, right? We have to start where we are. Start trying to bloom where we are. I've been in the same place almost my entire life. Trying to bloom where I am. You know, what choice do I have? You keep thinking grass is always greener, right? You think, if I'm just somewhere else, it'll go great. Not necessarily at all. So those who are tempted to be foolish and ask someone who has a piece of God to help God fixate their mind, wrongly interpret it, you know, definitely they shouldn't have access. They shouldn't have access to those with a piece of God, because they'll take it in the wrong way. So not having access is helpful for them. They won't get vain hope, their vain hopes going. Wow, what weather, weird weather we're having in California. It's a totally new pattern. It's just completely different. I don't know what to say. It doesn't feel the same as all. I was talking with someone today who's also lived here a long time. He said, we haven't felt anything like this in 20 years. I said, that's so true. This is just... I prefer the beautiful weather, of course. I mean, last year and the years before, it would be like summer right now. It'd be 80 degrees. Everyone's garden would be bursting with, you know, vegetables would be growing like crazy. I mean, but of course we had no water, so that was a problem. So now, I mean, the state is just dripping with water. Snowpack is just crazy. Almost all-time historic high snowpack. Very close. An epic, legendary year of precipitation and snow. And it just doesn't stop. It rained last night. It seems to rain every night, or every day we get some rain. Not a lot, but cool, cloudy, rainy. And then next week, again, same thing. We've been going like this for a long time. Every 4 days, another weather pattern comes in. And so this... next 15 days, cool, cloudy, rainy. You know, feels like it doesn't feel like California at all. But I'll take it, you know. Certainly don't want to play golf with this weather, I'll tell you that. So, just keep working out. Get stronger. Something to do. Someone told me that they work out as a stress buster. I agree, it is a stress buster. It really is. He said if he didn't do that, he'd go crazy. I said, understood. Yeah, wow. It just makes you feel, I don't know, makes you feel like you're doing something. But if you don't practice in the right way, you will go crazy. If you don't intentionally bring this suffering upon yourself in a skillful way, knowing how to recover from it, of the suffering of temporarily kind of feeling like you're kind of in like limbo, purgatory, of not really having a stable identity of expectations, not having a stable set of expectations. That's suffering. It's a kind of mental suffering. But we do it intentionally, knowing how to recover from this. This is the whole secret to success here. We have it. And this will... ultimately, everyone will have to turn to this one way or the other. So I'm just part of this ultimate success that everyone will have. I'm just part of being successful. You know, it's great to be on the winning side. It's the only side there is. The other side is futile. It's not a win-lose thing. It's what works and what's futile. It's like that. The other side can't win. So it's not a contest at all. It's no contest. Contest is between either side can win. This is no contest at all. It's already a done deal. It's the sure thing. The sure thing as opposed to complete futility. Those are the options we have. So pretty easy to choose. Well, it's getting kind of cool now. The sun is dipping down below a heavy cloud bank. It's probably going to get chilly. So we've... done some good work here. Oh yeah, wow, another 2 hour taping. It's just like easy, you know, just, oh yeah, another 2 hour taping. But not so easy, because I put suffering on myself. by that whole recognition of time, like, oh, we're getting really looking at that. Wow. All time is right now. It's just make-believe. Has no extension at all. Not even a moment's extension. It's just in the moment. But it's in each moment I'm dreaming of time as an inducement. Each moment. It never has any extension other than my dreaming of it. At all. None. That means we can drop all time. This instant is the only instant of time there is. It's an idea, it's a make-believe, wishful thinking in my mind. It has no extension. Never has. Never has. It's the same for everyone. It's just an inducement trick, technique we're trying to use, a trick we're trying to use. Hey, you're like, hey, mind fixator that you're hiding. I know you're down there somewhere. I know you're somewhere. You're hiding somewhere. Look at this time. Wouldn't you love to live in time? You know, wouldn't it be great? All you have to do is fixate my mind and you can have this. But there's no real extension to time at all. Zero. Whew. Hey, that burger I had. I said I had a burger. It was awesome. It was. I haven't had a burger in almost two years. I mean, so. Holy cow, that was a good burger. I might have another one. Wow, was that a great burger? But I'm sure I gained weight. I'm not weighing myself now. I'm too scared. I've been eating too much. And I had pizza last night. We were visiting that friend who's living with cancer, and we had pizza. I had a couple pieces of pizza. So I probably have gained some weight. I'm eating more because I feel so sore. I feel you want to like get rid of the soreness by eating a lot, but it doesn't work. That's the problem. Man, I don't take ibuprofen. I don't take anything for it. If I did, I'd be popping ibuprofen. Yeah, for sure. Knock it out. But then you get into that habit, and it's a bad road to go down. Really bad. Start getting overconfident, pushing yourself towards more and more fun. Next thing you know, you're living with cancer, and you're on morphine, and codeine, and all sorts of stuff. But hey. He's willing to take whatever it takes, you know, to get well. But they call it palliative. And of course, when you go on hospice, you go on morphine, you feel better. You think, hey, well, this isn't so bad at all. Maybe I'm getting better. They know better, right? Those who give you the morphine, they know how it goes. So, hey, God's prayers to him, and let him take up the challenge of the spiritual path. And if he does that, you know what? He'll get well. You say, you know what? I think I'm going to intentionally suffer so I don't need this other suffering. And I should tell this to my knee. Hey, knee, you know, I'm still practicing, you know, so I'm taking up intentional suffering so I don't need this because it's, you know, it's no fun to have a bad knee. It's no fun. You just feel like you can't really do much of anything. You got to be careful about whatever you do. You could hurt it again easily. But it's helping me out, helping everyone out greatly. Thank you, Nee, for being such an awesome help. I'm still practicing. But it guided me back to practicing more. I was getting away from it. Too much Facebook, you know. I still kept it up, but the trend was not good. And so now I'm more back hardcore practicing. You know, intensives are good for that. But there's some stuff that leads you. Facebook's like morphine. You feel like, hey, you know, I'm connecting with so many people. I'm interacting. This is great. I'm helping so many. I feel helping. But the long-term trend is really bad. I noticed that those who are on Facebook really addicted to it. They're in a bad trend. It's like someone with cancer who's on morphine. And I saw my friend, I said, man, you look great, you look so much better. He says, yeah, I feel better, I got more energy. And he feels like he's on the mend. Well, that's the drug talking. He says, oh, I'm in La La Land too. I mean, if I could feel it. Well, it's the drug talking. His trend is not necessarily a good one, although it's not a death sentence, okay? I mean, stuff can turn around. With God, turnaround is possible. If you accept the cross, you can get well from anything. You see, if you accept the cross of Jesus, and you crucify yourself on that cross with Jesus, you can get well from anything. Anything. You can actually rise from the dead, like Lazarus did. If he accepted Jesus' way of the cross, of intentionally crucifying, you know, suffering, crucifying your expectations, you can rise from the dead, literally. You're basically saying, okay, I'm going to take this path, Jesus, that you showed us that works so wonderfully well. And I know it's going to be take dedication and it's going to be tough, but I'm going to enjoy it. And this is the way I'm going to do this. Goodbye cancer. Goodbye anything and everything, actually. Any troubles, whatever. And if you need a little push, you can come back. You can come back on you. Sure. If you need it to come back on you, that motivates you again to get busy again. Get back on it. Yeah, that's fine. So this knee comes and goes. It gets bad sometimes. Gets better sometimes. It's kind of my thorn in the flesh. I can't overdo anything. I got to be gentle with what I'm doing. But that transfers over to be having a gentle practice, not overdoing it. Wow. I better get inside for this weather. I think it's going to rain tomorrow, actually. So I think a front is coming in. Another front. More rain. Surprise, surprise. Not a surprise to us anymore. This is the rainy winter of 2017. That is for sure. How long has it been going on? It started December. December, January, February, March. Now, April, it's going to be like 5 months. 5 months, wow. And that's what I prayed for. A lot of us prayed for it. I said, let it just be an epic rainy season. I don't care. I'll put up with it. So, no complaints here. We're happy chirping away here. Happy as birds chirping away. We're getting through it. And, you know, at some point, it'll stop raining. Maybe. Maybe it'll go into June. We don't know. May go all the way through May. It really could. It really could. And then it could be a cloudy, cool summer here. It's possible. Just helping the state cool down. But, hey, we got spoiled there, and we experienced just the most epic run of great good weather that I think the world's ever experienced. I really believe that. I don't believe there's ever been better weather in this history of the world than California had over the last 5 or 6 years. It's just like if we felt we were blessed, really. I felt that way. I felt this is just a miracle. It never stops. It's January, it's 85, and it's just like we're basking in this glorious, glorious atmosphere. And the next day, the same. And the next day, it's the same. And it's just tranquil and peaceful and calm and beautiful for like 6 years. Almost 6 years, it seems like. Heavenly, really. Maybe take it two different ways. Maybe that was just inducing us to keep trying here, or maybe it was preparing us for a reduced intensity, pure land realm. Gentle, peaceful place for those who know how to practice properly. Those who know how to practice properly, they can abide in a very gentle, beautiful, peaceful place and not lose sight of the goal. And use that as a positive inducement to help to get ready to be familiar with the peace of God. Absolutely they can. They'll use it in the right way. And that profane, they'll keep trying to, you know, induce a non-existent power to fixate their mind. They'll just keep trying by hook or by crook. And the play of heaven and hell, they're in the ocean of samsara, this terrible turbulence between hope and futility, hope and fear, that just ceaselessly generates turmoil up and down, this way and that way. And it's just horrible, horrible. driven. You feel compulsive, driven. You got to keep trying. You got to try this hook, this trick, this trick, this trick. Believe, you know, oh, God. Don't even want to think about it. Okay, so learn how to suffer intentionally in the right way. Don't need this other suffering. You don't need it. Don't need it. Okay, for those of you who are still watching, fortunate ones, fortunate ones. Because we are certainly still really getting to it here, big time. All right. Wow. That's for sure. Wow, wow, wow. Full stop on the wow. Keep on suffering and suffering in this way. All right, don't let anybody lead you astray. Keep on suffering in this way. Wow.